Hello, here we are back at Victoria Mansion for the second of our educational lectures. And today we're going to be focusing on the dining room. In our last lecture, we set the groundwork for how and why this building is here. And I just want to briefly review just a couple of key points of that before we start to really delve into the dining room. So you'll remember from our last lecture that this building is really here because of influences in Britain with the Industrial Revolution. And then it came over here because as America industrialized, the great sort of barons, if you like, of industry wanted to have buildings that reflected the best style of Europe. Many of these self-made men, self-made builders, if you like, of industry and so on, had tremendous prowess in terms of business, but they didn't have the confidence in terms of decoration, architecture, and design. And so for that, they turned to this new sort of this new breed of people called architects, whose styles and designs came from European style books. We mentioned a couple last time. We talked about Owen Jones, who had this wonderful book called The Ornament of Style. We talked about Jackson Dowling, who was a British designer who was connected to members of the Hudson School here in the United States in the painterly movements of the 19th century. We also talked about Jakob von Falk, and we have references to him in our literature here at the mansion. And I just want to remind you of one quote he made as an introduction to talking about the dining room today. So Jakob von Falk wrote in his Art in the House, and notice the word art, because in this period and in this house, architecture and art have come together to be on an equal playing field, if you like. So in his book, Art of the House, he said, "Insofar as style is concerned, the modern Frenchman dwells in the 18th century, he sleeps in that century likewise, but he dines in the 16th. Then on occasion, he smokes his cigar and enjoys his coffee in the Orient, while he takes his bath in Pompeii." So here we are, and we said this in the last lecture, Victoria Mansion is essentially a journey, a three-dimensional journey through some of the high points of European interior design, adapted and tailored to meet the Morse's aesthetic wants and their sort of social desires, if you like. So Morse was a very, very confident man, and he was also very exposed to the most current trends in design and architecture, having been in Boston, New York, and then in New Orleans. So he was able to source architects and interior designers like Herter to create his very own European palace, if you like. So today we're going to focus on the dining room, which is the 16th century, as Falk said, and it's Renaissance revival as designed and executed by Herter and Guidicini. So here we are in the dining room. And what is our first impression as you walk in here, if you were guests for dinner with the Morses? It's just this sort of magnificent, majestic sort of space. We can see the influences of the Renaissance that's on the outside of the building. The semicircular pediments, the triangular pediments here, these great arches and so on, and these tall windows. The immediate sense, I think, I would propose, is harmony. Everything fits together. It's integrated design. Warmth, integrity of style. He's weaving through the 16th century Renaissance feel in every aspect of the room. We also see an integration and harmony of motif and color, as we saw in Jackson Downing's recommendations in his style book that we talked about last time. Falk would approve of this room. And in his text, he said, "Such rooms have become works of art which ask us to gaze at them in wonder and admiration." And I think that's probably A, what the Morses want, and B, the effect that they achieved. And I think we see that when we have guests to the mansion, that they come in here and are really overwhelmed by the magnificence of this room. So let's have a look now at the prescriptions that there were for furniture. Falk talks about the core values of furniture design and construction. And he talked about the solidity of material and the thoroughness of workmanship. And I think, again, in this room, Hertha checks both those boxes. These pieces of furniture are really sort of monumental, almost. They're almost like, the sideboards are almost like freestanding temples, if you like. As is this magnificent window, or rather mirror, with its phenomenal framing around it and the candelabra in front of it. So how would Hertha have gone about setting up this room? The very first criterion is a concentration on the center of the room, of course, because that's the center of activity on this stage, if you like, the stage set. So you have this magnificent Anglo-French chandelier hanging above this wonderful table, which could expand to hold, I believe, 14 people. But the furniture should be unostentatious. It should be sober in style. Straight back chairs should be prescribed, but not too high, because otherwise it would make it difficult for the servers to serve the guests comfortably. So we have straight back of moderate height chairs. The wall is the background, if you like. And here we have this American chestnut, which is this warm, rich color that works beautifully with the choice of woods for the table and the chairs. The brown color of the wood, Falk prescribes, should produce an impression of intellectual as well as physical comfort. And it's very clear that Morse knew his stuff. He knew what he wanted in terms of each room being a period in European architectural and design history. And he wanted to show that intelligence, but he also wanted to show his aesthetic acuteness, if you like. And this room, again, captures that in spades. And then the wainscoting, the paneling, should not go all the way to the ceiling, says Falk, and it should be finished with a cornice which provides a grave and quiet air, a sort of noble dignity. And again, we can see that up here, that the paneling stops, and then you have these wonderful volutes that Guidicini made to look like wood above it. And we saw that too last time when we were talking about the Rococo in the reception room, that these nouveau riche, if you wanted to sort of assume, as they had in France in the 17th century, this idea of nobility, of kingship, even though they weren't of the royal line, but they wanted their buildings to look as though they were kingly. And they were, of course, kings of industry over here, so that consistency, I think, does make sense. So let's zoom in on the furniture, some of the pieces of furniture in this room. Where did the designs come from? Where did Hertha imagine and put together all these pieces so that they would integrate? A couple of things before we talk about though. In the 19th century, both in Europe and in the United States, people were hungry, and the pun is intended as we're in the dining room, they were hungry for French style. And how did these designs come across the Atlantic? Three ways, really. First was from the emigration of cabinet makers. And Hertha, we'll remember, emigrated to the United States in 1848 when there was this huge, huge turmoil in Europe. The second way that these styles came over were imported furniture. So some of the wealthiest, earliest kings of industry, if you like, actually bought some of the furniture that was in France that they saw in exhibitions and so on and brought it back to the States. And then the third one was the one that we've talked about before, was the dissemination of styles and suggestions and prescriptions, really, that we found in the various style books. The one I want to focus on today is one that we hadn't mentioned last time, but it's a style book by a Frenchman called Désiré Guimard, and the book was called Le Garde Meuble, almost like the keeper of furniture, which was published in 1844. So 4 years before Herta came over here. Now, while in the mid-19th century, French furniture produced in the United States does suggest a lot of influence of books like this, and particularly in this house, the connections, I think, are pretty compelling. And we know that there are some pieces from Le Garde Meuble that are still in the Philadelphia area, and that would also have sort of trickled up, I think, to Morse, you know, wanting to build his palace here in Portland. So let's now compare some of these pieces. The first piece I want to look at is the center of the room, and here we have in Guimard's book Le Garde Meuble, we have a dining table, which is expandable, as is this, and it has these two magnificent sort of pediment legs. And then it had a central leg, if you like, or style to support the center of the table, which would have been laden down with this fine furniture and sumptuous food. So we'll have a look at that. The other thing that was really important in these dining rooms were these sideboards, and they were not really used for serving, but more for the demonstration, the showing off of fine silver, of fine porcelain, and also to show off the craftsmanship of the carpenter maker, and to add more supports, if you like, for the integration of design themes in the room, which here are the fruits of the land, the sea, the hunt, and so on. So if we look at this one here, it's got a base and then the top part with the shelving, we'll see that it's highly decorated. It's got these wonderful styles in the center and on the side. And it's very monumental. It's like a piece of architecture in the room. And again, we'll close in on this sideboard here, which has the glass back to enlarge the room, but also has these great majestic sort of columns in the front, if you like, and the architrave and so on, that almost looks like a neoclassical or Renaissance building. And then the third piece we'll look at is one of the smaller sideboards, of which we have two on either side of this magnificent fireplace. And I'll be comparing it to this piece here, which again is a lower height, but it still is very majestic with these sort of architectural volutes, and then these wonderful carvings of these cornucopias of fruits and vegetables and so on. So let's take a closer look at the dining table. In the Grand Meuble, we saw that the table that is most similar to this expanded, and it had two very large supports. And here we see this with this enormously wonderful volute, this sort of serpentine shape here, which we've seen throughout the room. We'll see them on the sideboards, we see them on the furniture, and we see volutes on the ceiling. So you've got this integrity of design. Tremendous weight, sturdy support. This table hasn't got its middle leg in because it's not expanded to its full length. But still, I think the evidence here is that Guimard, in his Grand Meuble, would have recognized this as the type of furniture he had prescribed in his book. I also want to draw attention to this tiny piece here of faux marble, and I'll be talking a little bit later about the use of faux marble and faux wood in this room. It's an extraordinary detail that hardly anybody would have seen, because you'd have the tablecloth normally covering this table. But again, I think it's a testament to the primacy, not only of function, but of beauty for its own sake, which is redolent in this house. Now let's have a little close-up at one of the chairs here. We talked about its straight back. We can see that it's also got these sort of monumental columns, which are consistent to this sort of architectonic flavor, if you like, in this furniture. But I also want to show you these legs, which again, very few people would have perhaps paid attention to. The back, of course, is straight because it needs to be sturdy and movable. But the front have this beautiful sort of fluting and then this lovely sort of flourish, almost like a rosette, if you like, three quarters of the way up the leg. Now, I wanted to just go back to Le Gardemeur, Gallimard's text, and you'll see in this particular dining table that this design is exactly what we have here. Well, almost exactly. So you've got the fluting and then this wonderful sort of flourish here, but almost like a rosette. Again, it's a detail that most of the guests may not have noticed, but it mattered because of the integration of beauty and design and integrity of the artistic enterprise, if you like. So now let's look at this magnificent monumental sideboard. Again, it was not for serving purposes, it was for presentation purposes. Presentation of the architecture of the piece of furniture itself for its own sake, but also a demonstration of all the magnificent silver and china and so on that they would be demonstrating or showing off to their guests. The other thing that Hertha loved a lot, and we'll see it in several rooms, is the use of mirrors on the back sides, on the insides of pieces like this, but also in some of the side tables in the parlor, where the mirror expands the sense of space. And notice that it's opposite the mirror over the fireplace. So you've almost got that feel of the Palace of Versailles, where you've got reflection and light and expansion of space in almost every room, actually, as we'll see. And again here, we'll see these, as we saw in Gaimard's Grand Meuble, we can see these sort of columns. This is almost, you could almost imagine one, a caryatid, one of those Greek figures standing here. But here it's done with volutes and a column with this beautiful sort of leaf, like a vine leaf. And in the doors, we again have this cornucopia of food. We've got berries and apples and all sorts of delicious fruits and vegetables. And at the top, again, we have these columns as though it were a building with a half of a lute, which we saw elsewhere. We have oak leaves. And then at the top, we rise up to this magnificent pediment, again with this urn or ewer, if you like, at the top. And then these swags of corn and grapes and so on. And again, notice that tiny little piece of faux marble in the top, that green striated marble. Again, it's purely a decorative conceit, if you like, and it was hand done, and it's demonstrating the ability to create faux marble, which was an art in itself, which we'll talk about in a little bit. And then the last piece that we'll look at in this room is this other smaller, lower sideboard, of which there are two on either side of the fireplace. And again, we'll see that the designs, we've still got these sort of columns, if you like, that are these are exactly the same as the large sideboard we saw over there. And again, this motif here, it's almost like a heart-shaped shield, if you like, with fruits and so on in the center. The design layout is essentially the same as over on the other sideboard, but he's put in different types of fruit. So he's created the same shapes and forms, but with different fruits and vegetables. And then at the top here, we have, again, sort of flat surface and gorgeous designs back there that are hidden by this china. But these lovely sort of volutes, again, architectural volutes that hold and support this upper shelf. And then behind that, we have this the pediment, or this sort of whole architrave that we've seen in a major Renaissance-style building, with another ewer at the top, and fruits and vegetables. Now, instead of being in a swag, they're in a swag there because they're so high up and there's that sense of decoration by the ceiling. Here they're resting on the semicircular pediment. And again, something that people miss is around the either side of the lion head is a little lozenge, if you like, of faux marble made with, you know, with oil paint and so on, and to look like a sort of a verdigris Italian marble. again, this was would have been more as a showcase in and of itself, and a vehicle to show some of their beautiful china. So I'm going to sort of begin to close this talk with talking about, first of all, the methods of manufacturing. How did Herter and the people in his workshop make these amazing pieces of furniture and paneling and so on? So machines were used to create the rough sort of cutout, if you like, the base. And here we are in the 19th century, of course, so you've got this mechanization, industrialization. And the design, the architects and interior designers took advantage of that, the ability of machine power. But ultimately, you would then be moving on to sort of handcrafted finishing and so on of the pieces. But the machining did create an ability for some of this type of furniture to be produced for wealthy clients, but at a slightly less cost than if this had been completely done by hand from the start. So we've got this sort of the idea that these buildings came to the United States from from industrializing countries in Europe to the industrializing United States, and the furniture and so on also took advantage of the machinery and so on. So now let's just quickly talk about what some historians have talked as gendered spaces. Because yes, this was a dining room, but in these days, people didn't just come in, eat, and leave. You know, there was not sort of meals on the run. So typically, the parlor and the sitting room tended to be more sort of feminine spaces. After the main courses of the often 8-course, 9-course dinner had been completed, the ladies would withdraw to the parlor, while the men would stay here in this space, smoking their cigars, drinking fine fortified wines and brandies and all that sort of stuff. And so they would be sitting here immersed in this space. And I mentioned that the themes here are food, opulence, cornucopias, excessive amounts of produce and so on. And so what we see here, you have this idea of designs that show the prowess, if you like, of the owner. So they are self-made men. They may no longer be hunters and gatherers in the old-fashioned sense of the word, but this room captures the fruits of the hunt. And we've seen that. We've seen fish and wildlife in these lozenges on the ceiling, on the walls, fruits and vegetables, as we've said, on the tables and on the sideboards and then on the chairs. So naturalism was really important in the Renaissance, that idea of not just a representation, a virtual representation, but a visual representation of something in very naturalistic form. And we also see opulence. And in the Renaissance, flora and fauna were common themes. And Herter has put that here in the Renaissance revival. So such motifs were sometimes part of a historical formula, but on other occasions they would just exist outside. It would be like a general suggestion, and then the owners would craft and shape them to their own specific designs and compositions. The final thing I want to talk about today is perhaps something that people see first when they come in this room. And that's the ceiling, which is, of course, all faux painting. It's trompe l'œil, French term for fool the eye. And I just want to talk a little bit about why would Herter have wanted, and Morse too, to have faux marble and faux wood? They certainly could afford the real wood. But again, I think the point is that it was, again, traditional, in the Renaissance revival period, to have this idea of real wood juxtaposed with a representation of faux wood and faux marble. It was to demonstrate the artistry, if you like, the magnificence of being able to recreate in a naturalist form something with paint. So where did the faux marbling and faux woodwork, if you like, come from? It goes way back, in fact, to Egyptian times. It was used in the Egyptian and Roman periods as a decorative design. And then we're also indebted to the 15th century Flemish painters, the Van Eycks and so on of this world, because in 15th century Belgium and Holland, there was created the whole idea of oil-based paint. So pigments dissolved and floating in linseed oil, which is exactly the way those paints are today. But the huge discovery with the use of oil paint was that you could capture, you could create multiple layers and still have this luminescence, if you like, so that the lower layers were visible through the layers of the oil-based paint. By the 17th century, the laminating of tropical wood and so on became really fashionable in France. And again, it was a slightly cheaper alternative, for sure, but it was also, it represented this idea at the height, if you like, of luxurious interior design. And if you can, when you can pop over to England, Ham House, which is in Wiltshire, in sort of the Midlands of England, which was built in the 1639, has a lot of faux marble and faux wood graining. And then we have to say thank you to Robert Adam in the late 18th century. Robert Adam was a very illustrious architect, and it was he that really was fascinated by neoclassical design, and his designs, like Kenwood House in Hampstead, are redolent again with these features from the neoclassical period. And then that sort of evolved and came over again in the early 19th century to the United States. Now the US did have faux marbling on those wonderful floor cloths that you'll see in colonial houses, but the idea of doing faux marble and faux wood graining on walls and furniture was really a later introduction, which came to the attention of people from the Grand Exhibition at Crystal Palace in England in 1851, which was masterminded by Prince Albert, and also the Paris exhibition of 1855. So there we have it, these threads that I talked about in the first lecture, about threads crossing the Atlantic and then coming back, and we see the fruits of those interactions here in this room. And finally, one thing that I had not scripted at all, but which we're going to take advantage of today, is to have a peek in an area of the dining room that guests never see and docents rarely see. So we've all seen this double door on the back left-hand side of this room as we're looking into it. And we know that it was a space for the butlers and so on to do the final prep for the food. Food would be cooked elsewhere, brought up here and prepped and then served. But how many of us have actually seen inside? Well, today we're taking advantage of being able to do just that. So I'm going to open these very large, wonderful doors, which again have magnificent little details. Here's the second door. And And once we go in here, we'll see this tremendous space with prep areas here, which are low, and it's not because people were small, it is just more efficient. You know, if you're carrying heavy ewers and tureens and so on, it's far easier to take them from hip level than it is from waist level. Masses of storage here for the different knives and forks and so on, plates that you would need for all the different courses, and it was a very, very prescribed system that the butlers and so on would have to use. There's also a little wash sink here to just rinse things and so on. So it's quite a large space where you could have two people sort of working away, prepping food to deliver seamlessly out to the guests here. So it's a rather a nice treat and I think a nice sort of coda to this talk about the dining room, to be able to see this behind the wall, behind the staircase piece of the process of serving food in Victoria Mansion.